I want to welcome you to the 2018 kickoff of the debate series. It's going to be an exciting evening. Tonight we have the Senate District 27 and the Congressional Georgia 7. The time that we'll start is 6:30. We'll run the debates for 1 hour. We'll take a 15-minute recess and then start the congressional debates. A couple of housekeeping things to go over. We appreciate if everybody would turn off their cell phones. Secondarily, during the debates, we know that you're all here to support your candidate, but we will not have any booing, hissing, yelling, nothing like that. We want to respect the candidates. Want you to also mark your calendar for May 2nd. That's the Board of Education, Board of Commissioners, and State Court debates. And then May 8th is District 24 State House and District 25 State House. At this time, I'd like to ask Dave Crouch to come please lead us in the pledge and the prayer.
Thank you, Patrick. Good evening. We stand as in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance. To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll just remain standing for just a moment. We'll just have a quick opening prayer. Lord, we just thank you for the privilege to gather here this evening. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being free. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done for this country. And we just ask, Lord, that as we sit here and we listen and we learn from these gentlemen who are running for office, Lord, that you would give each and every one of them wisdom and guidance, and that you will see that this event is conducted in a godly manner. We just thank you, Lord, for being with us right here in this facility at this very minute. And we would just ask you to forgive us where we've fallen short of your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dave. You can be seated. At this time, I want to introduce the debate chairman, Justin Hawkins. He's going to draw who's going to, in what order the candidates are going to answer questions. And while he's doing that, I'm going to read the rules. Just so you'll kind of have a feel for what the candidates are going to be doing. Each candidate's going to be given 2 minutes to introduce themselves. We'll then go into the question phase. The moderator will ask a series of questions. She's not seen them yet, and the candidates have not seen them yet. They'll have 1 minute to answer the question. After that, they will have another opportunity to further clarify their answer or rebut what another candidate may have said. They'll have 1 minute to do that as well. During the final phase of the debate, each candidate will be entitled to ask one other candidate any question of their choice. We've asked them to limit that question to 30 seconds, and then the recipient will have 1 minute to answer. We have a timekeeper stationed right up front, Sarah Hughes. Thank you. She will be keeping time, and her timekeeping is final. What she says is what it is. We're going to ask the candidates to either turn off their phones or give their phones to someone on their staff. We don't want any texting to the candidates or from the candidates. As we've asked all of you, we're going to ask them to conduct themselves with the appropriate decorum. We do support free speech, but crude language and disruptive behavior will not be tolerated. If that's it, I think we're ready to get our questions ended. So what we're going in. Finally, I want to introduce the moderator. Carolyn Fisher is over here. She's the moderator tonight. Carolyn's a former student. We thought that she would do well. She was a school teacher for 31 years, so we thought she'd be able to handle these guys pretty good. She's a former precinct chair, She's the former second vice chair, the former first vice chair, and the former chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party. She's presently serving as the first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party. Thank you, Carolyn.
With all of you tonight, I want to let everybody know that I have not seen or had anything to do with the questions that are going to be asked. The only thing that I have done is I called Mr. Bell this afternoon and asked him to please print the questions in a large enough font. I would also like to say that I know each one of these gentlemen and feel as though they are a friend, each of them are, and so I will call them by their first name if that is all right with you, and sometimes I may call them by their first and last name, depending upon how they behave. So we'll begin with Mr. Fielder Bill. Here is the first question. Oh, sorry. All right, Bill, you have 2 minutes to give your opening.
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank Carolyn and Patrick for being here, and both my opposition as well. So my name is Bill Fielder, and I'm running for State Senate District 27. I'm a third-generation Georgian, a true conservative Georgian, a 20-year Forsyth County resident. I am a pro-Trump conservative Republican, and I'm a small businessman. I grew up in Columbus, Georgia, during the time of the Vietnam War, and I came from a very conservative setting, and I've been conservative since, you can't see my hand, but childhood. In addition to being in that conservative setting, my elementary school teacher, principal in the fifth and sixth grade was Mr. Hancock. Can't recall his first name, never was told it actually, and I've tried to Google it, but can't find it. And he was a direct descendant of John Hancock, so he steeped us in traditional values, conservative values, put respect for the flag and patriotism. I've always been in support of the military and veterans. Natural extension of that, the way my dad brought me up, is to be supportive of law enforcement officers and Second Amendment rights. And I hate the idea of an open border or a sanctuary city. I believe that life begins at conception, and I believe in the right to life. And the thing that got me interested in running for State Senate, even though I've never run for office before or ever been appointed in any capacity in a government seat like my opposition has, was RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, a straightforward 8-page bill that protects people, places, and organizations from prosecution for refusing to provide service on established religious beliefs. And that is what motivated me to run for State Senate and serve the citizens of Forsyth County. Thank you.
Mr. Tam.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for coming tonight. I want to thank the Forsyth County Republican Party for the opportunity to speak tonight. As parts of our state and nation have continued to struggle, we have focused our attention on positioning ourselves as a great place in which to live, work, raise a family, and retire. Our thriving economy, low tax rate, first-class schools, public safety, and award-winning parks and recreation facilities have made Forsyth County a destination for families and businesses. And it is with this reputation that we are presented with both challenges and opportunities. I believe the Gold Dome could use a little more Forsyth County and our brand of bold, conservative leadership. I have a record of working for you, not special interests. As your senator, I will continue to fight to protect our quality of life, preserve our heritage, promote private sector job creation, ensure every child has access to a quality education, and tackle the opioid epidemic strangling our families and this community. For too long, Forsyth County has been a victim, resulting in our hard-earned tax dollars being sent to other counties and other regions in the state. I will continue fighting to return those dollars home where we as a community know best how to spend them. While serving on the Board of Commissioners, I championed reducing the millage rate on three separate occasions while balancing our county's budget during times of prosperity and throughout the worst recession witnessed by our nation in a generation. I know what it takes to find solutions, navigate complicated government agencies, and deliver results. From the widening of Georgia 400 to securing funding for the Alliance Academy for Innovation, I have a proven and tested record of showing up for work and getting the job done. My name is Brian Tam, and I wish to represent you in the State Senate. I ask for your prayers, your support, and your vote.
Dolezal.
Hello, everybody. My name is Greg Dolezal. Carolyn, I want to thank you and the Forsyth County Republican Party for having us, Brian and Bill. Thank you all for being here. I'm not sure if you're just hiding from the pollen storm if you're interested in politics, but thank you for being here tonight. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a Forsyth County businessman and entrepreneur. I have the opportunity of owning multiple businesses here in Forsyth County and working with organizations all around the world. I've worked with Chris Tomlin and Pastor Louis Giglio as the producer for Worship Night in America and Passion Conferences. I started to engage in Forsyth County politics in 2013 when I started Fix Forsyth Traffic. And from there, I went on to fight President Obama's overreach and radical housing policies for coming here to Forsyth County. But tonight is not about my biography. Tonight is about the future of our community. My favorite member of the community is here tonight, Natalie Dolezal. She is my wife of almost 11 years. She is the mother to my three children who are five and under, and we have our fourth on the way. They are the reason that I'm running for State Senate. You know, I've talked to many of you here in this room tonight, and you say that it's time for bold, conservative leadership. Leaders who stand tall for our values. Leaders who don't crumble in the face of pressure. Leaders who will pull up their sleeves and get to work. I'm going to work to unlock traffic gridlock in Forsyth County. I'm going to work to finally get our kids out of trailers and into classrooms. I'm going to finally eliminate the state income tax right here in Georgia. Can I get an amen? I will keep our community safe by continuing to ban sanctuary cities. I'm going to do all of that, and then I'm going to come home. I'm going to come home because I'm not interested in a career in politics. I am interested in keeping Forsyth County the best place to live, work, and raise a family. My name is Greg Dolezal. I am the conservative that you can count on, and I thank you so much for coming to hear my vision tonight.
And now we'll go to our first question. Thank you, gentlemen. Question? We're going to go to Bill Fielder first. Here's the first question, Bill. Forsyth County seems to be fractured over land use, private property rights, and how to deal with growth. As a state senator, what do you feel will be your role in addressing this?
So when I think about Forsyth County, what I think about is that it's out of balance, that it's out over the tips of its skis, and that there are a lot of moving parts, and that the politicians and the people who claim to have helped in the past have not been much assistance at all. The main function of the state senator, your state senator, will be to bring as much of Forsyth County's money and funds as it can back to Forsyth County from the state capitol. And when it brings it back, to support the infrastructure, to build out the infrastructure to relieve the pressure that you feel now, and not for that money to go to special interests.
Thank you. Brian, do you need for me to read the question again?
If you don't mind.
Forsyth County seems to be fractured over land use, private property rights, and how to deal with growth. As a state senator, what do you feel will be your role in addressing this?
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to say I'd be accessible. I'd be accessible to the public. I'd be in ear to hear their problems, to hear their concerns, and to roll up my sleeves and get involved with the issues. I'd work very hard at the Gold Dome to bring our tax dollars home. We are a donor county. As I said earlier, too often our tax dollars go to other parts of the state. And finally, I would work to unify the county and not divide us. Dividing the county just divides up our resources, it divides up our wealth, and it makes us not able to advance infrastructure and amenities as we otherwise could.
Thank you, Brian. Greg, Would you like for me to read the question again?
I think I got it. Thank you, Carolyn. Okay. You know, you're right. Forsyth County is fractured today over issues like land use. And what we need are leaders who know how to bring people together. If you look at my website, you'll see a list of a number of community leaders who happen to fall on opposite sides of the land use conversation here in Forsyth County. I've worked to bring those leaders together. As a matter of fact, just this Monday night, I hosted a meeting in my office with people who have various opposing concerns on how we move forward with representation and whether or not Forsyth County needs more municipalities. We had a spirited conversation, and we had an agreement about how to move forward with engaging each other online. That is what I'm going to do as a leader. That is what leaders do. Leaders don't work behind the scenes to build division. Leaders bring people together. And what you learn when you bring people together, what we heard at that table on Monday night, is that Forsyth County is not as divided as some people would have us think. Forsyth County embraces our conservative values. Forsyth County embraces a vision of moving forward with low taxes and a prosperous place to live. And that's what we're gonna do, as I'm glad we'll do as a state senator.
Thank you, Greg. We're gonna go back now and ask Bill, is there anything that you would like to rebut with either one of your opponents?
There's a lot of talk about bringing Forsyth County together when it shouldn't be fragmented in the first place. There's a lot of talk about bringing funds from the state capital back to Forsyth County, and there's only one candidate that has the sufficient 4 decades long experience to help accomplish that task, and that is me.
Thank you. Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
You know, track records are interesting things, aren't they? You're going to hear each of us tonight tell you about the merits of our track records. I think what you need to do is you need to look not at just what we say tonight, but what has actually been accomplished. I think that the bulk of Forsyth County people want to see more job centers here in Forsyth County, and they want to see us stop rezoning our commercial land to high-density residential. When I served on the Comprehensive Plan Steering Committee, we significantly moved the needle to doing just that, and now we have a board of commissioners who are implementing the plan. Because of what I've done in the past, Forsyth County is going to be a better place, and because of what I will do in the future, Forsyth County will be a better place.
Thank you. Now we're going to go to Brian for question number two. Brian, how do you propose to resolve Georgia's and Forsyth County's traffic congestion issues?
Well, thank you. First of all, I'd like to say I think we took a giant step forward with our partnerships with the Georgia Department of Transportation while I was serving as the chairman of the Transportation Committee. Georgia 400, lanes 5 and 6 are just about complete. It's time to start talking to them about lanes 7 and 8, and it's time to start talking to them about taking the project further north. We need to continue to build partnerships with GDOT. There are a number of roads that are out there. For example, Bethelview Road, GDOT is paying for the construction. However, we partnered up with them. That is not a state highway. Castleberry Road, they gave us $1 million to put towards that road because we got it shovel ready, which means that we already had the right-of-way, we already had the engineering, made that road ready to go. These are the types of discussions and these are the types of relationships we need to have with GDOT, and I have done that.
No, you know, I think that our traffic woes are no secret to anybody, which when I was a private citizen in 2013, I had done everything right. We were living in Forsyth County. We moved our business to Forsyth County. I had a 7-mile commute that was taking me 45 minutes. A lot of you are living that same nightmare every day. Brian mentioned Castleberry Road. What you do as a state senator, as a county commissioner, whatever you're going to lead, is the exact opposite of what was done on Castleberry Road. Castleberry Road was a $20 million road widening project for a road that had 7,300 cars a day, which is exactly half the amount required to widen a road per our county regulations. Old Atlanta Road, for those of you who live in South Forsyth, got pushed to the back of the line, and it is not finished today because we rushed to get Castleberry Road done. I will look to make sure that we do the right projects, that my decisions are data-driven, not driven by special interests and crony capitalists.
Thank you. Do I need to read anything?
No, no, thank you. So this is all intertwined in the fragmentation of Forsyth County, but Old Atlanta is a disaster. Old Atlanta Road is a disaster. That's absolutely right. Castleberry is a road that is built a bit before its time. So again, the politicians, the people who've been involved in addressing this problem in the past haven't gotten it right, and that includes both of the opposition candidates here tonight. I will work with people who I have not yet developed relationships with, because those relationships bind my opposition into delivering obligations on both sides. And you'll get with me an impartial view of how to address and bring back, again, the money that's necessary to support the state projects in Forsyth County. And I'm most interested in Forsyth County, not really the rest of the state of Georgia.
Yes, if you don't mind, how long do I have? Thank you. All right, for those that don't think it was necessary to widen Castleberry Road, they should visit with the families who lost loved ones on Castleberry Road. The role of government is to provide for the health and welfare of its citizens. That road was not just widened because of traffic count, it was relocated. It was relocated so that it had better sight distance, so that it had better geometry, so that it was safer. People were dying on the road. The road was shovel ready, which means the county got it ready by acquiring the right of way and by doing the engineering. That was done several boards, or ordered several boards, before I came into office. The final vote on Castleberry Road was around the $10 or $11 million mark. Again, we needed to widen that road to provide for the safety of our citizens.
Thank you, Brian. Having a problem getting the button exactly right. Greg, do you have anything you'd like to piggyback on?
I do, thank you. I want you guys to remember one word tonight when Brian speaks, and that's the word obfuscation. For 12 years, we heard obfuscation. We saw smoke and mirrors. Castleberry Road did not need to be widened. Anybody who has looked into the topic knows that I'm exactly right. As a matter of fact, Commissioner Todd Levent, who was the sitting district commissioner where Castleberry Road lies, presented an alternative plan. County's legal counsel stated that alternative plan would be acceptable. It was a plan to straighten the road, not to widen the road and build a road to nowhere. I just want to add something else that we can do here in Forsyth County. By the way, the Castleberry Road vote, final vote, was a 3-2 vote. Brian flipped his vote, and it was a flipped vote to serve his special interests. Something that we can do that's very simple is to open up our arterial roads. We need synced lights here in Forsyth County around the state of Georgia. We need longer turn lanes. We need to see more and more flashing yellows. That's low-hanging fruit, and that's things that we can do that will move the needle to get our traffic moving.
Thank you. Bill, you have anything that you'd like to
add? I do not have anything to add. Thank you.
All right, we'll go to Greg. Sorry about the buttons. We're going to go to Greg now, and we're going to piggyback on that question, and we're going to ask you with a follow-up, what is the best way to fund and construct state transportation projects as well as county projects? And I ask you to remember that I did say the word state, not just county.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. You know, in 2015, the Georgia delegation passed the largest tax increase in the history of the state of Georgia. It was HB 170. And what it did was it moved us from a sales tax on gasoline to an excise tax on gasoline. And GDOT's budget more than doubled overnight. In addition to that, the Georgia budget has increased approximately 50% over the last 8 years. Unlocking traffic gridlock is a core competency of government, isn't it? That's something that we know that government should do. So since we have GDOT's money, the budget doubled overnight. Since state funds have increased over 50% in the last 8 years, we have more than enough money to fund state roads without taking more money out of the pockets of Georgians.
Bill?
Can you read the question again, please?
Yes, I will. We're going to follow up on the question before. by asking what is the best way to fund and construct, and remember, this is also state. I'm asking about state transportation as well as county projects.
Thank you. Well, I disagree with Greg. Government doesn't have a core competency other than raising taxes. And I also disagree with Greg. The state budget is up 66% in the last 7 years, from $15 billion to $25 billion. Actually, now it's $26 billion in this next fiscal year. Government doesn't have, and the state of Georgia doesn't have much or any financial discipline, and it doesn't have much or any accountability. And so the first thing that needs to be done to fund really everything that the state needs to fund is to introduce accountability and discipline. And you will find that within the state budget, the needs of the citizens of Forsyth County and the state of Georgia can be met with the existing budgets. Thank you.
Brian.
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like for me to read the question?
No, ma'am.
Do you? You've got it.
So this is the situation. There are 159 counties in Georgia, and there are 159 counties at the Gold Dome at the Georgia Department of Transportation asking for funding. That doesn't include the municipalities. So the funding is scarce. The best way to do this is through planned partnerships. There are planned partnerships going on right now in Forsyth County. Although these projects are lagging behind, mostly due to the recession and our inability to bring funding back to our county, as I mentioned before, Bethelview Road, Castleberry Road, Georgia 400, and yes, even Highway 20 have both county and state funds involved in them. You have to go down there with a plan, with a reason, a way to solve the problem. You just can't go down there and drop it in their lap and expect them to run back up here with funding. I will also speak to Greg's House Bill 170. House Bill 170, the problem with 170 is, I'll wait till rebuttal. Thank you.
I do not.
I would just like to mention that planned partnerships are another form of taxation, the government's core competency. And what I don't want to see is for that form of taxation to be used to feed the special interests in this county.
Brian.
Yes, my rebuttal. Greg's comment about House Bill 170, here's the problem. Problem with House Bill 170 is you have a seven-member state delegation, and four of them voted for it, and three of them voted against it. And the bottom line is there were no major projects to speak of that came to Forsyth County. The way to do that is to build a consensus and say, hey, Governor, we have seven votes, and here is our list of projects that we want for Forsyth County. If you remember House Bill 170, which you probably don't, because there really weren't any town hall meetings about it or any open forum to discuss it or people to go on the record and tell you how they were going to vote for it. We lost out.
Okay, we're going to go to the next question. And the person who is up is Bill. Do you support the creation of a new city in South Forsyth County, and tell us why or why not?
So what I believe is that all Forsyth Countyans, Forsythians, have the right to choose their own form of government. And I would not be a person who would want to be in the way of people in Forsyth County choosing their own form of government, whether it's in South Forsyth or whether in North Forsyth. On a personal note, what I'll add to that is that rarely is more government a good answer. And my fear is that there will be a build out of additional costs that are uncontrollable. For instance, in just one instance, There's a salary proposed for a mayor of $15,000 a year. There's been no discussion about the cost of a city manager or the cost of staff or all of the other costs. And so on a personal note, I think it's an extremely risky proposition.
Thank you. Brian?
Yes, thank you very much. As I stated in part at the town hall meeting a few weeks ago, another layer of government is not the answer. It solves nothing. It's a decentralization of services. It divides up our resources. I am not in favor. I'm a no. For those of you who are opposed to it, I want you to know I am with you. I am opposed to it. To those of you that are for it, I want to be your ear and try to work with you and hear your concerns. But this is not the answer. This solves nothing.
All right, I'm going to go to Greg.
I'm not in favor of a new city at this time in Forsyth County. I'm not in favor of a new city in the foreseeable future, as far as my eye can see, in Forsyth County. The reason for that is I do not believe we have exhausted all options for better representation. I think it's important that we back up and talk about why this is even a conversation. I find it interesting that Brian is now willing to be an ear. But the reality is that for 12 years, Brian's ear was in the mouths of the special interests, if you will. He's owned 11,000 high-density attached housing units here in Forsyth County in 12 years. People are looking for better representation. I think that there's better representation that we can do by changing the county charter. I think that we can move to a hybrid model for our Board of Commissioners. I think that we can have the option for a supermajority required to overrule a district commissioner in their own commission district. Because right now,
okay, Bill, do you have anything that you would like to rebut?
Thank you.
Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
Thank you, I was kind of seamless there. Right now, you have the ability to vote for one county commissioner, one. Three of them can make decisions for something in your backyard and you cannot touch them at the ballot box. That is not representative government. I believe that many of you have been disenfranchised by that model. Before we do anything new relative to new municipalities, I want to see us fix the model and put in place the most representative model that we can. Zoning decisions should be pushed locally down to the local level. When I was on the Planning Commission, I was charged with making decisions for areas that were 30, 40 minutes away from me. Quite frankly, I wasn't the best person to do that. There are multiple things that we can do to bring better government to Forsyth County. I was calling for that for a couple of years, wrote a letter to my commissioners years ago, and unfortunately, nothing was done.
As a point of order, may I get my minute now? Thank you.
All right, we're gonna go to another question, and that question is, you know that you all, while you will
be- It's me, Carolyn.
Pardon?
Is this for me or is this?
This is going to be for Brian.
Thank you.
At first. That you all, while coming from being a part of the Forsyth delegation, you do represent the people of the state of Georgia. In what ways do you propose that education in the state can be improved? And that goes to Brian first.
Thank you. Well, first of all, the more we can keep it local, with local control, and allow our local school system to make decisions locally, the better off we're going to be. We have the best school system in the state of Georgia. We have highest graduation rate, highest test scores, the list goes on and on and on. And this is done by local control. Our community is very involved in our school system. I'm proud that my family is as well. This is what it takes to build a quality school system. The school system is the benchmark for for which a community is measured. And the more we keep it local, the better off we are.
Greg.
I agree with Brian. We need to keep control local for our schools. We need to do everything that we can to encourage President Trump and Secretary DeVos to get rid of Common Core. We need Georgia-grown standards here in Georgia. We need to do everything that we can do to get our kids here in Forsyth County out of crowded schools. For the children who are not fortunate enough to be in Forsyth County, we need to provide an escape hatch for them out of their failing schools. We need to put put parents in charge of the education of their children, and we need to give choices and options for education. I would support tax credits or vouchers. I've been endorsed by House Rep Wes Cantrell, who through another school choice bill this year, and I look forward to working with people like Wes moving forward to provide choices and options in education and unleash free market principles to get the best education in the hands of our students.
Bill.
Thank you, Carolyn. The closer to home that education occurs, the better off the community. And that is true for all of the state, all of the counties in the state. And it is extremely difficult to be able to pass along your core values as a community to your children unless you can bring those issues and that control of your school, your board of education, as close to home as possible. I support school choice. I support homeschooling. I had the wonderful opportunity of judging some homeschoolers in a debate on Saturday. And you know, the future of America is not lost. These were wonderful young people who were smart, who were respectful, who knew how to conduct themselves well in society, and they really amazed me. I do support vouchers, and I oppose Common Core and have from the beginning.
Thank you, Bill. Brian, do you have anything you'd like to rebut?
I do. One of the things I'm most proud of while serving on the Board of Commissioners is that I was able to initiate the funding for the Alliance Academy. Many of you probably haven't heard of it, but you know what? It's got 600 kids it's going to open up with this year, and it's already full. That's right, 600 kids are going there and they haven't even seen it. This is a school, there's one of three in the state, and at this school, it is funded a large portion of through local dollars, the Public Facilities Authority. It has no gymnasium, it has no football field, it has no performing arts center. It is for kids who want to follow career paths, and there's a demand for that. That school was built in half the time for half the money. And that is something that we really need to, that this community has embraced.
Great.
Again, I just want to say that I support student-centric models to education. I'll give you guys a couple of bullet points of things that I think that we can do that will move the needle, some very specific things. Right now, our state school board is not elected. It's appointed. I want to see all of our state school board members elected so they are accountable to each and every one of you in the state of Georgia. I want to see charter schools funded at the average level. Right now, it's at a low level. We need to fund charter schools. And again, the principle here is that we don't necessarily need the help in Forsyth County. But when we have failing schools in Georgia, they drag down our state numbers. And when the state numbers are dragged down, it casts a shadow over all of the schools in Georgia. Education is a core competency of government. We have a constitutional requirement in the state of Georgia to provide a QBE, which is a quality basic education. The state this year has finally fully funded that. That is good news for us. And I'm going to make sure that we continue to do that in the future as well.
Thank you. Bill?
I'll just add that we need to support our teachers, our new teachers across the state, so that when they begin what they decided to make as their career, they end up not getting washed out or burned out in 3 years. We need to develop programs that identify those teachers that may be at risk and provide the support for them so that they enjoy their job, love their job, and support children the best.
Thank you. All right, we're gonna go to Greg now, and this is a good one. What is your position regarding the legalization of cannabis products for medical purposes, and what is your position for recreational purposes?
That's a good question. Thank you, Carolyn. Georgia actually has some of the loosest cannabis laws regarding medical cannabis in the Southeast. We currently have 14 allowed diagnoses that will allow you to be prescribed medical cannabis. I am supportive of that. I have often told my wife, if we have had the conversation, if our child suffered from one of those diseases, that I would do what I needed to do. And I think that is something that we need to empower parents to be able to do for their children. On the recreational side, I'm not supportive of medical cannabis in Georgia. I'm sorry. On the recreational side, I'm not supportive of recreational cannabis in Georgia. Thanks.
Thank you. Bill?
Thank you, Carolyn. So let me just start with, I am not in support of recreational marijuana use in the state of Georgia. So let me talk about medical marijuana use for a moment. I believe this is one way to help address the opioid epidemic that we are experiencing by using medical marijuana to help people who are in pain and people who are suffering from things like the side effects of chemotherapy. So this includes people of all ages, children and adults. And there are children who suffer seizures, multiple hundreds of seizures a day, and medical marijuana absolutely addresses those issues. So where there's proven efficacy, I'm in full support of the use of medical marijuana. Thank you.
Brian.
I don't know how to say what they said differently, but I do not support recreational marijuana at all. I do support medical marijuana for cannabis oil for doctor close supervision.
All right, let's see. Greg, do you have anything that you...
I do. I'd just like to add, my friend David Clark, who's in the House, introduced a measure this year to add a 15th diagnosis, and that's PTSD. My brother was in the Air Force, fought in Iraq and Afghanistan, served in Diego Garcia. While he was there, he was injured, had a head injury. Took him a while to figure out what was going on. Eventually, he got a medical discharge. He was having absent seizures. He came home and he suffered tremendously from PTSD. He was in and out of VA rehab 3 separate times for alcoholism. It was a strain on our family. And I would like to offer options to people like my brother, veterans like my brother, who come home and need medical care. All of the above approach, it's the least that we can do for them.
Thank you. Bill, anything?
No, thank you. I don't have anything.
Brian? Yet.
Thank
you. No, ma'am.
Okay, we're going to go to Bill now. And this is the question that I want to ask. What should the state of Georgia do to reduce the costs of health care?
Well, to me, the first and most obvious answer is to get rid of Obamacare. Of course, the state of Georgia can't get rid of Obamacare. That badly needs to happen. And I've been in support of Trump from day one since Trump announced his candidacy. And that is the first step to getting ready to make healthcare more efficient and less costly. I do believe that Georgia can take some steps, and those steps are to make the market as competitive as possible, so that providers and capitalism can take control of the market. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian.
Well, first of all, Obamacare, the rules that have come in with that clearly aren't working. There needs to be a more competitive environment which local, or not necessarily local, but private firms can get in the marketplace and start providing care and offering it at a reasonable price, and they would compete with one another.
Thank you, Brian. Greg?
Thank you. My business partners are here tonight, and every year for the last 5 years, we have faced double-digit increase for us to provide health care to our employees. As a small business owner, something I've dealt with here in the state of Georgia, and I have a specific plan. There's a number of things that we can do, among which are to create high-risk pools to put people with pre-existing conditions into a high-risk pool. 34 other states have high-risk pools. Georgia needs to become number 35. This will drive down costs. We need to repeal certificates of need. Certificates of need cost 4% for an insured person, 7% to provide for Medicaid. Finally, We need to begin to use technology and data analytics for state employees, similar to what Tennessee and North Carolina are doing. I said finally, but I'll give one more finally. We need to level the playing field between individual purchased insurance and employer purchased insurance, and remove the taxation from individual placed, purchased insurance.
Thank you, Greg. We're going to go. Bill, do you have anything that you'd like to?
I do. I would just submit to you that high-risk pools, part of Greg's answer, really just take the cost off of business and put it onto the state, and actually puts it on the back of the citizenry of the state. I don't see that as something that really addresses the overall cost of health care. I would also say that, again, Obamacare must go because it has other limitations on business, and it is a it shackles business with tremendous burdens and regulations. And across the board in Georgia, we should remove regulations in every place possible, including healthcare.
Thank you. Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
I agree with my two opponents that we need to repeal Obamacare. I was heavily disappointed when I saw John McCain cast the deciding vote in dramatic fashion. To me, that was example A of why we need term limits. I'm the only candidate in this race who has signed a term limit pledge and applied a term limit to myself. I do want to address this Trump thing, though. I received the mailer from Bill saying that he's the only pro-Trump candidate in the race and that he's been pro-Trump from the beginning. I like Bill. He's a sharp guy. He's a nice guy. Bill did not vote in the 2016 Republican primary. He could not have been pro-Trump from the beginning. If that was an outlier, I would think that that would be okay. Bill did not vote in 2012. When we were trying to remove Barack Obama from office. That was after Obamacare. That was after Putin needing flexibility. That was after the $787 billion stimulus package. Bill has voted in one Republican primary in the last 25 years.
Okay, we're gonna go to Brian now. Brian, what will you do to prevent illegal immigration in Georgia?
Everything possible. My businesses participate in E-Verify. We are very thorough and make sure that when we hire somebody, they have the proper documentation. We run it through the system. We do everything we can. You know, this is a problem for us. For us as a community, because you have an economy that people are not paying their taxes on, that people are getting paid in cash, that people are standing on the side of the road and getting picked up and put to work without being on the payroll. So I am all about stopping illegal immigration.
Great.
Sorry, I want to start with a principle. And that principle is that legal immigration enriches our culture and illegal immigration impoverishes our culture. So that's the high-level principle, right? I'm going to continue to make sure that we ban sanctuary cities here in Georgia. And to the extent that Decatur or Emory want to become sanctuary cities, I'm going to work to defund them of every penny possible of state funding. Secondly, I'm going to work with Sheriff Ron Freeman, who is here tonight and has endorsed my campaign, to implement a 287G program. That's a program that will deputize his agents to enforce immigration laws after arrest and after due process. We cannot only rely on ICE, we have a fantastic sheriff's department here, and we need to allow them to help us solve the criminal illegal immigration problem in Georgia.
Bill.
Thank you, Carolyn. I do agree with Greg. We absolutely do need to implement the 287 illegal immigration deportation program. This law allows local enforcement to work with ICE and to get across the state and to deport illegal aliens. Legal immigration, when done well, is the kind of thing that you see when you see my mother, who is the product of two people who met at an orphanage, one Spanish immigrant and one is a Swedish immigrant. And works because the family came together when my parents met at USO Dance in the 50s when my dad was in the Air Force. Sanctuary cities need to be defunded. The border needs to be controlled. and illegal immigration needs to be completely stopped.
Nothing.
I agree with everything Bill said. A couple other things that we can do to help us with illegal immigration. Right now, E-Verify is only required on small businesses with 10 employees or more. I would like to see universal E-Verify in Georgia. It's something that we do in all of our businesses. It's not a significant burden. It's something that small businesses can do as well. Something else I would like to see happen, I will have no control over this, but I will lobby my elected officials, and that is to bring our troops home from Iraq and Afghanistan. We've been at war for 17 years, and we have never declared war. We need to bring our troops home, get them off of foreign soil, and we need to allow them to help us protect and defend our border. My campaign manager is here tonight. His name's Alf Chall. He's a first-generation immigrant from Brazil. Like Bill's mother, he did immigration the right way. When immigration is done right, it enriches our culture. We need to allow people who have done the right thing to pursue the American dream.
Bill.
No, thank you.
All right, we're going to go to the next question. And this will be our final question, gentlemen. And then you will have your wrap-up statement. Oh, that's right. Quickly, what are your top legislative priorities in the General Assembly next year? Greg.
That's for me. Fantastic. I'm excited to be coming in 2019. We're going to have a new governor, a new lieutenant governor, and a new legislature. So we're going to have the opportunity to finally move the needle on the conservative agenda. I want to eliminate the state income tax in Georgia and put more money into each and every one of your pockets. I want to do what we just talked about, and that is continue to ban sanctuary cities. All of our Republican gubernatorial candidates have gotten behind religious freedom. I've been endorsed by Sam Teasley, who is the author of the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in the Georgia House. And I want to work with Sam and my fellow legislators to get RFRA to the governor's desk for the second time and then ensure that the governor signs it.
Bill.
Yeah, it's interesting that Greg talks about RFRA. Greg has taken money, lobbyist money, from McGuire Woods, and has gotten in bed with the lobbyist firm that led the fight to defeat RFRA in the past. Greg is talking about all of the people who support him and represent the establishment who haven't accomplished anything in the last 12 years in state government. And I think that Greg, who has talked about his endorsement tonight from Ron Freeman, and I know Ron Freeman, he's a wholesome man, he's a God-fearing man, and he is a warrior for this county. And I'm curious as to whether he knew that Greg would get in bed with the people who opposed RFRA when Greg sought his endorsement. And Greg, I would ask you to get out of bed with those folks, to recant your alliance with the people who lead RFRA, and send the money back.
Brian.
Top things I want to do as your next state senator revolve mainly around funding, because that's something that affects us all immediately. First of all, transportation. This county worked hard to get 400 lanes 5 and 6 near completion. It's time to start working on lanes 7 and 8. It's time to start negotiating moving that project further north. You know, the county entered into a transportation bond and it's only acquired half the funding so far. It doesn't have to borrow more money with the right relationships downtown. Some of these relationships that we have resulted in, and I'm very proud to say, $350 million in commitments from the Georgia Department of Transportation for Highway 9, plans for Post Road, for McGinnis Ferry Road, and for the interchange at McGinnis Ferry and Georgia 400. Secondly, school funding. You know what we have going?
All right, Greg, do you have anything you want to rebut?
I'm not going to rebut. I'm going to add to my legislative agenda because I actually have one. I want to ensure that we fully fund our schools here in Forsyth County. About half of our students sit in overcrowded schools today, and we have a problem getting our money for the state. There's a number of things that we can do to make sure that we get our money back here and that we get our kids out of trailers and into classrooms. Another thing that I want to do, I want to put a constitutional cap on state spending. You mentioned the numbers before, my round number of 50-something percent, bill offer number 60-something percent. The reality is, the exact number, I should say, this is going to shock you as soon as I find it here, the state budget has increased from $17.5 billion in 2011 to $26.2 billion in 2019. We need to cap state spending and begin to starve the beast of government.
Bill. RFRA is what motivated me, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. Just like in local education, you cannot pass along your culture, your beliefs, and your system, and your outlook on life to your children without local education. You cannot do that without RFRA. When you have to be worried about how you tell your children they should be raised and how they should act and comport themselves, but your hands are tied and you have to worry about losing everything you've ever accomplished in your life because the RFRA law doesn't exist, it really does infuriate me. So that is a motivation and a legislative agenda. Illegal immigration, it is what it is, and it's straightforward, and we need to be stronger about it. Both my opponents are part of the establishment and special interests. I am not, and I can accomplish these things, these legislative agendas, without owing anything. Greg has over 200 endorsements. By the time he's returned favors to all those endorsements, he won't have any time to accomplish the legislative agenda.
Brian.
Thank you. I'm just going to continue on with funding back to our county. First of all, school funding. I'm a big proponent. I support school impact fees. While on the Board of Commissioners, I initiated a revision to our impact fee policies. We need more funding for our schools. We need money for safety for our schools. We need to partner up with the state to make sure that we can build more things like the Alliance Academy and get funding for those. And then I'm a big fan of accountability courts. Accountability courts such as drug court, the mental health court, these sorts of things that went into play when I came into office, keep people out of the prison system and rehabilitate them so they don't go down the same road they just came from.
All right, we have come to the part of our debate where each candidate may ask one other candidate a question on any topic. You have 30 seconds to ask your question, and the person who you ask the question has 1 minute to respond. And we're going to start with Greg. You may ask a question.
Thank you, Carolyn. My question tonight's for Brian. Brian, you know I like your restaurants. I told you the creme brulee is probably the best in town. It's really good, folks. In the spirit of a good restaurant, Brian, I'd like to offer you a menu tonight. And your choices are as follows. Your 2008 millage rate increase. Your 2009 millage rate increase. Your failed proposal in 2010 to raise the millage rate 40%. Your energy excise tax. Your cell phone tax. Brian, of all of your tax increases, which one is your favorite?
Well, thank you, Greg. I'll go ahead and straighten it out. You said 2008 millage rate. I was a no. 2009, I was a no. 2010, I brought forward the recommendation of staff to this room, and after hearing the comments from the public, when the vote came forward to raise the millage rate in 2010, I voted against it. So, I'm an ice cream guy, I guess.
Brian.
Yes.
You may ask a question.
Oh, okay. My question's for Greg. While I was in office for about 5 years with smoke and ears and ignoring my constituents. The park and recreation bond was already approved and something interesting happened. You moved here.
Yeah.
Other than your lovely wife having family here, why did you choose to move to Forsyth County after I've been in office roughly 5 years?
Brian, I don't know who does your opposition research. I moved here in 2006, so you might need to fire your opposition research guy. I moved here because I fell in love with my beautiful wife. She's a graduate of Forsyth Central High School, and she is everything that is right about this community. And as a point of order, and we have we can put this on our website later tonight, when Brian left office, the millage rate in Forsyth County was 30% higher than when he entered office. Forsyth County's population grew 69% while Brian was in office, but county spending grew 139%. County bonds increased 183%. The county millage rate, as I mentioned, increased. The county property taxes collected increased 147%. And county bonds, not including schools and county revenue, increased 519%. So Brian, I love this community. Regretfully, the tax bill is higher than it needs to be. But to answer your question, I moved here because I fell in love with Natalie Pritchett.
Yeah. And Bill.
A little has been said about my pro-Trump stance and the fact that I came out for Trump first thing after he announced. I came out for Trump in a huge way on social media, in a big way. So much so that it caught the attention of some local leaders who, in fact, asked me to run for state senate. And I looked at RFRA and I decided between that question and RFRA, the answer was yes.
All right.
I didn't get to ask my question, sorry.
Is that it?
Well, she said stop, so.
Okay, we're fine with that now. All right, so here is the next part. We're going to, each one of you will have 1.5 minutes to make a closing statement. He had 30 seconds. Each one of you will have 1.5 minutes to make a closing statement. And we're going to begin with Greg.
Thank you, Carolyn. Let me close by saying thank you to the Forsyth County Republican Party for hosting this debate, for all of you for being here tonight. It's really, really impressive. I want to thank Brian and Bill for participating. And I know that by working with the men and women in this room, by the way, about half of which have endorsed me, you are my special interest, by the way, we can create a state and county that is stronger than ever before. What you've heard tonight is a stark difference in how we're going to do that. We can turn to a career politician who saddled us with higher taxes, crippling debt, gridlocked roads, and overcrowded schools. Or we can opt for a businessman who's been absent in our quest for the conservative cause. Someone who's voted for Republican one time in a primary in the last 25 years. It didn't help us get Barack Obama out of office. I'm running because I believe you deserve a better option. I'm going to work to find high-tech, high-paying jobs for our families and children, because as a businessman in Forsyth County, I've done it. I'm going to continue to lead the fight to allow families to spend more time together and less time in traffic. As an active member of our community, I've done it. I'm going to work to keep your taxes low and make sure developers pay their fair share. As an effective leader, I've done it. I'm going to protect our values from liberal overreach because as a concerned citizen, I've done it. I'm a business owner, I'm a devoted father, I'm a husband, and I'm the conservative that you can count on to get the job done. I would ask for your vote on May 22nd.
Thank you very much, Greg. Bill?
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I just want to say, once again, what excited me about doing this was RFRA. I am going to fight for the citizens of Forsyth County. What you have in front of you is a business person who has worked for 4 decades and already brought thousands of jobs through the acquisition, public offering, and help of 3 technology companies in Forsyth Company. It happened before Greg got here, so I guess he doesn't know about it. I also will work for each of you to keep the special interests from getting their hands on money that is meant to come back here and support Forsyth County citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Brian?
Thank you. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity tonight. Thank you for coming out, folks. Thank you, Greg and Bill. There's a saying, if it walks like a duck, talks like a duck, chances are it's a duck. If you're funded and supported and endorsed by the special interest of the Sharon Springs Group, you are Sharon Springs. If you want someone who's going to add a new layer of government and seven new politicians to Forsyth County, I am not your guy. But if you want someone who will unify and represent all of Forsyth County, I am your guy. If you want someone who is tested and ready to go to work on day one, I am your guy. If you want someone who has proven results, widening Georgia 400, partnering and backing law enforcement, helping businesses succeed, and fighting to return tax dollars to Forsyth County, I am your guy. I have shown I can protect our values, and now more than ever, it's time for the Gold Dome to have a little more Forsyth County under it. For those of you opposed to the city of Sharon Springs, I am your voice. To those of you who support it, I want to be your ear. I have worked before to unite this county on many issues over the years. Parks and recreation, transportation, public safety. We've shown we can be united. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank the Forsyth County Republican Party for asking me to moderate this debate tonight. I want to thank each and every one of you for following the rules. And I want to thank each of the gentlemen who came out tonight and worked hard to be able to answer the questions that they did not know anything about before they came. And I also want to thank you for behaving like such gentlemen. Thank you very, very much.
We'll take about a 10-minute break and then we'll get started with the congressional debate.